Good day, my dear friends. Welcome back to Easy and Different Radiology. I am Dr. Osam Ibrahim, and today I will talk about new sessions or new group from the interesting radiology cases. Today I will talk about the five practical cases, discussions, and answer. So let's get started. The learning objective from my presentation today is I presented one case. And this case, I will don't mention the type of examinations or MRI sequence to give you more step for the challenging. And I give 10 seconds for every case to answer for the questions or to detect the diagnosis. And then I will make discussions and explanation. And at the end, the answer. Let's start by the first case. This patient is 54-year-old man, presented with progressive dyspnea and a non-productive cough, no history of drug toxicity. And this is the examinations. I will give you 10 seconds and then complete with the discussion and explanation. First of all, what is the type of this examination? This is a CT examinations done without contrast and showing the details of the lung, so it is called HRCT or high resolution CT, unenhanced high resolution CT, because it is done without contrast. So this unenhanced CT, what is the discussions about it? This unenhanced, they have key points or keywords here. First of all, at that level, you can see the bronchi which are dilated and attracted. So this is which is called the traction bronchiectasis. And also there are subpleural cystic lesions arranged in rows and have thick wall. All these cystic lesions are peripheral distributed and have thick wall. So this is which is called the honeycomb pattern. The honeycomb pattern in the post-lung fields are looks like this honeycomb. So it is called the honeycombing due to this picture of the honeycomb. Second keyword here is the traction bronchiectasis, and this traction bronchiectasis is resulting from volume loss and fibrosis in the post lung fields. The third word is the architecture distortions. As you see in the post lung fields, there are reticular opacities and pleural thickening, subpleural lines. All these features that are resulting in architecture distortion. And at the end, the lower lobe predominance, as we see here, this is the regions of the after tracheal bifurcations, and this is the regions there are no tracheal bifurcations, there are hard. So all these cuts are in the lower lobes. So lower lobe predominance of these changes of the lung is consistent with diagnosing of the lung fibrosis. And the lung fibrosis in the lower lobe, the differential diagnosis can be remembered by the mnemonic word Krebs. What is the differential diagnosis of the lung fibrosis in the lower lobe? The first one is the cryptogenic fibrosing alveolitis from C or idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. The R is the rheumatoid arthritis. And rheumatoid arthritis can be diagnosed or excluded if you have any history of laboratory findings or of the rheumatoid, or also in the film you can detect any arthropathy of the shoulder joint or any joint in the film to confirm your diagnosing or to suspect or raise possibility of the diagnosing of rheumatoid. The third one in the differential is asbestosis, and asbestosis needs to be diagnosed with pleural plaques or calcified pleural plaques. If there are calcified pleural plaques, raise the possibility to choose this one from the list of differential diagnosis. And bleomycin also can result in the same picture. Bleomycin, this is one example from the drug toxicity, and the drug toxicity can be excluded by the history. As in this case, in the history, I mentioned there are no drug toxicity. Bleomycin or other radiotherapy or chemotherapy drugs, the amiodarone also, or drugs for the myocardial infarctions can cause lung fibrosis. So the drug toxicity can be remembered or should be remembered as a cause for the lung fibrosis. The last one, is from scleroderma, and scleroderma can cause basal lung fibrosis or lower lobe lung fibrosis in this form by honeycomb, traction bronchitis, architectural distortions, but it also associated with dilatation of esophagus, and esophagus can be noted as lower cuts here as dilated tubular structure, and this is not occurs in this case. So we excluding rheumatoid, excluding asbestosis due to no plaques, excluding bleomycin from the history, and excluding scleroderma due to there are no dilatation of the esophagus. So the remaining part is or remaining one from the differential is IPF, and it can be diagnosed by exclusion of other causes of differential diagnosis. So the final diagnosing of this case is idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, and it has another name which is called usual interstitial pneumonia, and this is pathological term, and it is also common in the exam as a term for the lung fibrosis, and it can be mentioned as UIP or IPF for the idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis as a final diagnosis for the first case. And now with the case 2. Case 2 is 47-year-old woman presented with left abdominal pain and weight loss over 3 months. And this is the examination. This is two different type of examination. I give you 10 seconds to discriminate or recognize which type of examination at least and what is the pathology after that. The first image is representing a CT study because the bone is appeared bright and the ribs appeared bright also. So this is CT study. With contrast or without contrast, look at the vessels. The vessels aorta appearing not opacified. However, there are opacifying branches in the portal venous branches in the liver. So this meaning that this is delayed phase. And there are also oral contrast, which appearing bright here in the stomach. So this study is a post-contrast study in the delayed phase, sometimes it's called equilibrium phase. So equilibrium phase meaning delayed phase due to presence of contrast in the portal venous branches or hepatic branches and not appearing in the aorta. And what about this image? What is the type of examination? This image, because the bone here appearing dark, so this image is the MRI image. MRI, look at the aorta and the portal vein, there are contrast within it. So this is a post-contrast study, T1, gradient echo, portal phase. So this is the examination type. And where is the lesion? Can you detect the lesions? There are lesions appearing here as a hypodense area in the spleen. This is the spleen and this is the liver, and also appearing also hypointense in that sequence of MRI. Let's go to the discussion to discuss these lesions in the next slides. So the keyword is in our case 2 is presence of this hypodensity in the post-contrast study. So post-contrast study hypovascular lesion in CT and also in MRI in this T2, this is another sequence because the CSF around the cord appearing bright. So this is the T2 sequence. T2 sequence also appearing hypo-intense or low signal comparing with normal parenchyma of the spleen. So there are hypo-intense lesion in the T2, and this is another key word to make it in differential diagnosis or to recognize the lesions from the other differential diagnosis. And this is the last one which I presented it in the front, which is a contrast study MRI T1 gradient echo in the portal venous phase. Also the lesions appearing hypovascular in the MRI or not taking the contrast in that phase at least. So hypovascular in CT, hypovascular lesions in MRI and low signal in the T2, this is the keywords for this case to diagnose it. And this is the lesions after pathology, and this is the lesions appearing here infiltrating the spleen and also affecting in the subcapsular regions as we see here, and also there are foci of siderotic nodules appearing in the anterior aspect of the spleen. So the differential diagnosing of that lesions with these criteria is the lymphoma and the metastasis. However, lymphoma appearing hypointense in T2, this is the T2, hypointense in the T2, however, metastasis have high signal in the T2. So you can differentiate lymphoma from metastasis through this MRI sequence, T2 sequence. So the final diagnosing for this case, which appearing hypovascular in the equilibrium phase CT, hypovascular in the portal phase in MRI, and low intensity in the T2 weighted image, is the splenic lymphoma. And case 3, asymptomatic patient, 54 years old woman. And this is one examination, and this is another examination done. 10 seconds to discriminate the type of examination and the lesion as well. So this examination is CT because the ribs appear here bright, and this is the kidney, and this is the lesions between the kidney and the spleen. So this is sequence is unenhanced sagittal reformat CT. This is a sagittal reformat image from the CT, unenhanced because the kidney have no contrast in the parenchyma or in the pelvic ciliary system. But what about this sequence? This sequence is representing a T2 sequence, and this one is a stair as the fat is suppressed in mesenteric fat and all structures in the image appeared suppressed. So this is stair image. So T2, the lesion which appearing here like this, appearing here heterogeneous signal, and in the stair image showing central area of suppression of fat suppression in this stair image. So what is this type of lesions? We're going to the next slides to see the keywords. Discussion and explanation. The keyword in this case is the fat component in the CT. As we see, this is the CT sagittal reformat image showing that lesion which appearing in the superior aspect of the kidney, and also appearing multiple foci of fat signal within the lesion. And this is the first key in our keywords which helping in the diagnosing of this lesion. And next keyword is the macroscopic fat. Macroscopic fat which appearing suppressed in the stair image. This is MRI stair image, and this is the lesions which appearing at the adrenal gland left side, and the adrenal gland lesions showing suppressed of fat, suppression of fat representing fatty component within the lesion. And no microscopic fat detected in out of phase. This is a study which is called in phase and out of phase, because out of phase appearing Indian ink artifact marginating all the structure like spleen, like liver, like stomach and the pancreas. So this is out of phase and this is in phase. The lesion appearing here and also appearing in the other side without no changes. So this is in phase and this is out of phase. No changes appeared in out of phase or no suppression of signal. This is meaning no microscopic fat within the lesion. So this is the three keywords which I depend on to make differential diagnosis. The differential diagnosis of these adrenal lesions is adrenal myeloliboma or adrenal adenoma. In the adrenal myeloliboma, the lesions appearing macroscopic fat or have macroscopic fat component, and the macroscopic fat is suppressed in stair image. However, the adrenal adenoma containing microscopic fat not suppressed in the stair image, however, it should be appeared dark signal or suppressed of signal in out of phase, which is not happen in this case. So there are no macroscopic fat in this case. However, there are macroscopic fat due to suppression in the stair sequence. So what is the diagnosing now? The diagnosing of these lesions is fatty lesions in the adrenal left adrenal gland, which appearing fat component in the CT and suppressed in the fat suppressions, meaning the macroscopic fat containing, and no suppression of signal in the opposed phase, which meaning no microscopic fat. So this is a final diagnosing of the macroscopic fatty lesion in the adrenal gland is the adrenal myeloma. Now case 4. This is 9-year-old boy complained of acute left hip pain for 3 weeks. This is one examination and this is another examination. If you look at the frontal chest, frontal pelvic X-ray, this is the frontal pelvic X-ray. There are no slipped epiphyses of the epiphyses of the femur. There are no Pierce's disease or collapsed or sclerosis within the hip, and there are no dislocations in the hip. There are also osteochondral lesions which appearing here due to syndesmosis of the ischial bone. So what is the lesions appearing here? No lesions is seen clearly in the X-ray. In the osteomyelitis, the X-ray may be appeared normal in the first 2 weeks or the 10 days. However, the bone scan in the osteomyelitis is highly sensitive for early detection of the disease, as we saw in the frontal image of the bone scan. This is which is called the bone scan, and the bone scan showing increased intensity lesions or hyper intense lesions or tracer uptake in the head and the neck of the left femur. So these lesions showing high intensity, so it have high sensitivity for diagnosing of infection. The bone scan, the bone within bone appearance or sequestrations better to detected in CT. So the CT of this child showing bone within bone or sequestrations in the head of the left femur, and this is the CT. However, MRI is very important for diagnosing the extent of the lesions and also to exclude osteomyelitis from other differential diagnosis of the acute hip pain. So this is the MRI stair sequence because all the fat and the muscles are suppressed. So the lesions appearing here as a bright signal in the neck of the left femur extending to the physis, and there are bright component in the epiphysis also. The para femoral soft tissue showing also hyper intensity. So this is the lesion and which appearing and this is the extent of the lesion. Bone sequestrations, bone within bone, and lesions in the metaphysis extending to the physis with high tracer uptake, as we see in the bone scan, and the X-ray appeared normal. The differential diagnosis of acute hip pain, including acute osteomyelitis, leg left bursitis disease. However, this is excluded because there are no collapse or irregularity of the epiphysis. Septic arthritis also should be diagnosed if there are joint effusion, and the toxic synovitis. There are no abnormal signal in the synovium also. So this is the differential diagnosis of the acute hip pain in the child. And also the other less possibility diagnosing is the neoplasm and collagen vascular disease or retroperitoneal abscesses, which can also cause pain in the child hip. However, the diagnosing here after all these keywords is considered, the final diagnosing for these lesions with sequestrations and high intensity in bone scan and abnormal signal in stair is the acute osteomyelitis. Kiss 5 is a 43-year-old man who was admitted to the emergency room with seizure. And this is an MRI examination in sagittal view. And this is an MRI with contrast. This is an MRI T1, as the T is a white matter appearing bright and the gray matter appearing dark. Subcutaneous fat is bright, so this all retroperitoneal fat is bright. So this is a T1 weighted image, and this is T1 post contrast study, and this is the lesions which are appearing here in the T1 without contrast and have intense enhancement in the post contrast study. Let's go to the next slides for discussion. This is our lesions also, which are appearing in T2 as a bright signal and surrounding by a little bit edema. First keywords here is the dural base of the lesions, as the lesions is sitting in the dura, appearing in axial and sagittal imaging and confirmed also in all pulse sequence. And also presence of this tail of enhancement, this is which is called the dural tail, and the dural tail enhancement here and the dural base locations, this one from the keyword for diagnosing of that patient. The next word is the homogeneous enhancement, because the post contrast study showing homogeneous enhancement of the lesions and also in the dural tail. And the extra axial location of the lesions, all these keywords helping in diagnosing of the lesion. There are no CT here, however, presence of calcifications and hyperostosis also raise the possibility of diagnosing of these lesions, which is considered a meningioma. So the final diagnosing for case 5 is a convexity meningioma, which appearing here in the left occipital lobe with dural tail in the convexity. The meningioma occurring by 90% in supratentorial locations, and majority of cases occurred in the parasagittal or the convexity. So this is the one from the convexity meningioma as a final diagnosis. And now, as I promise you, there are two cases for challenging. I will answer it in the next Wednesday. So this case 6, which to be continued in the next Wednesday. This study is technetium 99 mmHg HMPAO for cerebral scintigraphy scan. Try to solve the problem and diagnosing it, and I will give the answer in next presentation. This is case 7. Also, this is breast MRI. And also the answer will be continued in next Wednesday, so I give it for challenging. I hope this lesson has helped to make a few things clearer for you. And all of you are invited to my Facebook group. If you're searching in Facebook by Easy and Different Radiology, you can find and make a request, and I will accept it or request it for this group, which I provide cases, daily work cases in this group, and discuss it with you. Also, you can watch more than 100 presentations in my YouTube channels by searching in Google search. The name of the channel is Easy and Different Radiology. And also, as I promise you, every Wednesday, like this Wednesday, I introduce 5 cases and discuss it with you, and give 2 extra cases to be continued in next week. And also every Sundays for FRCR part 1, I starting the anatomy sessions, the first one in the previous Sundays, and the next Sunday the second sessions. I hope everyone have a good luck, and thank you for watching, and go have a nice day.